just give a brief introduction, and then we'll begin, and you will probably come in very soon. So welcome on behalf of Crossroads Cultural Center. Tonight's event is dedicated to the ongoing debate about the possible legislation of assisted suicide, or in some cases, even euthanasia. End-of-life issues are not easy to discuss because they involve very fundamental questions, such as the meaning and scope of individual freedom, and the very value of human life, and the nature of the medical profession. For this event, we have asked our speakers to help us understand better two basic questions. The first question is, what motivates the current push towards assisted suicide? What cultural forces are at work, and how should we respond to them? Contemporary culture places a disproportionate emphasis on individual autonomy, but is that the only criterion? Is our death really just our own? Or does the idea of legal euthanasia ignore the fact that how we live and die has profound consequences on the lives of the people around us? The last question leads us to the second theme that we would like to discuss tonight, namely the apparent inability of our culture to attribute any value to the unavoidable suffering that is associated with dying. Nothing makes suffering more unbearable than the perception that it is utterly meaningless. But is it really so? Is it possible to discover a possibility of good even in suffering? We are fortunate to have two very distinguished guests who can help us to answer these questions. Dr. Margaret Somerville is Samuel Gale Professor of Law, professor in the Faculty of Medicine, and founding director of the Center for Medicine, Ethics, and Law at McGill University in Montreal. She has an extensive national and international publishing and speaking record and frequently comments in all forms of media. Her books include The Ethical Canary, Science, Society, and the Human Spirit, and The Ethical Imagination, Journeys of the Human Spirit. Among her many honors and awards are the Order of Australia, 8 honorary doctorates, and the UNESCO Prize for Ethics in Science. Dr. Daniel SULMASY is the Kilbride-Clinton Professor of Medicine and Ethics in the Department of Medicine and Divinity School at the University of Chicago, where he serves as Associate Director of the MacLean Center for Clinical Medical Ethics. He has previously held faculty positions at New York Medical College and at Georgetown University. He received his AB and MD degrees from Cornell University and his PhD in philosophy from Georgetown University. He has served on numerous governmental advisory committees. He is the author of 4 books and serves as editor-in-chief of the journal Theoretical Medicine and Bioethics. His numerous articles have appeared in medical, philosophical, and theological journals, and he has lectured widely, both in the United States and abroad. Dr. SULMASY is a member of Crossroads Advisory Board. And now we'll begin with our speakers. Thank you.
For over 30 years, so when you have 25 minutes to say something about it, it's a little difficult. What I'd like to do, if there's time, is to ask a question: why are we debating euthanasia now? And then, if there is time, the second part of the discussion would be what are the strategies and issues that are being raised in order to promote euthanasia? How is this being done? Because I think we need to understand that if we're going to counteract those trends, and I'm assuming that you don't agree with them, I put it on the table, I don't agree with them. But we need to be much more sophisticated about how we deal with that, I think, than we've been up until this point. So the first thing is, why are we debating this now? Because there's nothing new about euthanasia. People have always become ill, they become terminally ill, suffering, they want to die, and we've always been able to kill them. And in fact, we can do very much more now to relieve suffering than we could ever do in the past. And yet our kind of societies have prohibited euthanasia for thousands of years. So why suddenly do we think that this is a good idea? And what I would suggest to you is that it's not the situation of the dying person that is the cause of this claim and this debate, although the situation of the dying person is the main thrust that people who argue for euthanasia use to argue that it should be legalized. And I believe that there's a whole lot of factors, profound changes in our postmodern, secular, Western democratic societies, and that those changes have a complex interaction, and it's their cumulative effects that are leading to this debate. So what I want to do now is identify what some of those factors are. And the first one is what I call intense individualism. Some individualism is good, but intense individualism is when the individual's choices and claims to rights are always given priority, and no matter what the harm to the family, the community, or the society. And that position favors the acceptance of euthanasia. Moral relativism is when you say that there are no absolute moral rules. It's just a matter of personal preference. And if I think this is moral, then that's moral for me. You think something different, well, that's moral for you. So what we have to do in this situation is, first of all, to recognize that there are different levels at which the arguments about euthanasia need to be investigated. And they are the micro or the individual level, the meso or the institutional level, and the macro or the societal level, and these days, with our interconnectivity, the global level as well. So, here, what we get from this intense individualism, which is relevant to the context in which we talk about euthanasia, because euthanasia is where we talk about seriously ill people and often dying people. So what you get from this intense individualism, you get this fear of dying alone or unloved. And that seems to be a universal human fear. It makes one wonder whether in some way it might not even be genetically programmed into us. You could think of all sorts of theories, like that if we were a lone human being in the past, in our distant past, we were probably much more vulnerable to being killed or harmed than if we were in a group. People have lost a sense of family and community, and what has happened with that is that what used to be relationships between intimates, for example in the family, and where the family looked after the person who was dying, has now become relationships between strangers. Over 80% of people in North America die in a hospital, although the figures are that about 80% of them want to die at home. Now, so again, that's a sort of an isolation. Death has become a medical event that takes place in great isolation, and it's been professionalized, technologized, depersonalized, and dehumanized. One of the things that you hear people say is, I don't want to be captured by those doctors and their machines. I don't want to die with all these tubes coming out of me. And you see these gruesome photos of a dying person with tubes comes out of every orifice of their bodies. And so what all of those factors together do is that they make euthanasia seem an attractive option. The late Dr. Jay Katz, who was at Yale, he was a psychiatrist, and he wrote a book called The Silent World of Doctor and Patient. And in that book, he talked about people who were dying suffering from what he called intense pre-mortem loneliness. And that's a terrible thing. I mean, loneliness is awful at the best of times, but when you're dying, I think it focuses into a whole lot of fears, so that you'd rather be dead than left in that state of intense pre-mortem loneliness. Now, a second factor is, and it's been mentioned already, and Dr. SULMASY is going to talk about this, is attitudes to suffering. And I just want to tell you one little story about that, because I'm going to leave that to Dr. SULMASY. But I was teaching a class of 40 graduate law students. And out of the 40, there was only one of them who thought that there was anything to be concerned about with legalizing euthanasia. Now, you've got to recognize that I come from Canada, and these will be our future politicians and judges and lawyers who will decide what the law should be. And I was shocked by this. Some of them did say, well, you know, of course you've got to stop abuse of it, but that's the only thing you need to be worried about. And one of them came to me afterwards and said that they thought that their reactions came not because they thought euthanasia was such a great thing, but because they had an intense aversion to suffering. And when you talk to these students, what you found was that they labeled suffering as the greatest of all evils. And therefore, anything that you could do that would relieve suffering was acceptable. So even though they didn't welcome euthanasia, they thought it was acceptable because it was relief of suffering. Another factor is our mainstream media. And on the whole, you will find that most of the people in media, I don't know whether that's true in the US, perhaps not Fox News, a lot of them are very pro-euthanasia. They're very pro-individual autonomy. And is this too loud?
No.
Oh, okay. What I've called the mediatization of euthanasia means that what happens is we fail to consider the impact of euthanasia at societal levels or its impact on cultural values. And it favors very much concentrating the euthanasia debate just on people who want euthanasia. It makes gripping television to have somebody, for instance, I was debating a woman in Canada who went to the Supreme Court of Canada in the end and lost her case. She argued that banning assisted suicide was constitutionally invalid. And in this debate with her, she said to me, but you even give a person condemned to death their last wish, not that we have capital punishment, thank God, in Canada. And she said, so why wouldn't you give me my last wish, which is that I have somebody help me to die? And she was a very powerful force. You can't wheel society onto the set of the television program and say, well, if you do this, this is what's going to happen. This is what will happen to your values. This is what will happen to your society. And I often say to people that when we're thinking about legalizing euthanasia, we should ask ourselves the question, not just how it will be used in the immediate present, but how would it be used, how would your great-great-grandchildren die if we legalize this? And so that there is a problem from the mass media in that regard. It's very difficult to put the case against euthanasia into easily accessible forms of mass media. And so I think that's another factor that's causing this debate to swing very strongly, at least in Canada it seems, to pro-euthanasia. Another reason is denial of death and death talk. If you read Ernest Beck's book, We Are a Death-Denying, Death-Obsessed Society. Now, I have a theory that we actually have to talk about death in order to accommodate the reality of death into the living of our lives, and to be able to live those lives with a reasonable amount of comfort, and with to live them fully, and to live them with hope and with optimism. And my theory is that what the function that religion played in the past was that it gave us a place and a time where we engaged within that place and for that limited time in the death talk that we needed to accommodate death. And with the breakdown of religion, much more serious in, I believe, in countries other than the United States, certainly in Canada, the vast majority of people don't belong to a religion and don't go to church, and the same is true in Australia, another country with which I'm familiar. And therefore, we've lost that forum, that weekly forum for death talk, and I believe that's caused that we still need to engage in that death talk, and I believe it's spilled out into our society in general, and that we engage in it through the media, and that that means it's much harder to control it, and that it raises generalized fear. So I think that fear is another factor in generating this euthanasia push, because what happens is it's much more difficult to deny death once it's out in the general society, and particularly because religion usually gave people hope that they could move through death and that there was still something that they could look forward to. And so one reaction that we have to fear is to try to take control. So if you think that our fear of death has spilled out into society and that we're trying to take control of it, we can't eliminate death, but we can create an illusion that it's optional by having euthanasia. And we can also feel that there is some control, that we can choose the time, the place, and the method, rather than, in other words, we get death, we take it on before it takes us on. And we also have to think about that people are not only fearful as individuals, but societies also have levels of fear. And so, for instance, I'd suggest to you that the high level of fear of crime in our streets is a marker of a fearful society. What we're told is that the fear of crime and people's impression of how much crime occurs is much higher than what the actual reality is. And so again, one way of looking at euthanasia would be that it symbolically tames and civilizes death. It says, well, you know, we might be frightened, but we can take control of this fear. And what the social psychologists call that sort of taking control and feeling that you, that and that reduces your fear, is they call it a terror reduction mechanism or a terror management device. And so I think that fear is another reason why we're pushing for euthanasia. And by the way, when I use the term euthanasia, I include in that physician-assisted suicide. The vast majority of the ethical and legal issues for both of them are the same, and so I'm just using the term euthanasia to include them both. Now, another thing that happens when we're fearful is that we tend to use the law as a response to fear. And so what we see is a rise of legalism in our societies, and that's also connected with our societies converting from being almost entirely relationships between intimates to relationships between strangers, which have happened for a variety of reasons. The families have broken up, we're so much more mobile around the world, we're much larger societies, we don't have a common values base, we don't all more or less belong to the same religion, so we've become a society of intimates. A society of strangers, and stranger relationships are governed by law. Intimate relationships tend to be governed by ethics. And you can see that, for example, in divorce suits and medical malpractice suits. When the intimate relationship between the husband and the wife breaks down, they sue in the divorce courts, they use law. When the quasi-intimate relationship between the physician and the patient breaks down as it does in malpractice, then the patient sues again in the courts. They turn to the law rather than that relationship being governed by ethics. And so matters such as euthanasia, which once would have been the topic of moral or religious discourse, are now explored in courts and legislatures. And what we have now as well is this change from natural law, which is where we thought that there were truths that we could rely on and that we would all agree with them, to what's man-made law, which is called legal positivism, which is a form of moral relativism. It says the law is what I say it is, and I can more or less say whatever it is I want it to be. And so what that results in is that law plays a very dominant role in establishing the values and symbols of a secular society. And what we get, I believe, is death talk, but now instead of being in our churches, synagogues, mosques, prayer houses, the death talk is taking place in our secular cathedrals, which are our legislatures and our courts. And that's certainly true in Canada. We've got it in, currently, we've got it in the courts, and we've got it in legislatures. So, the next factor, we're also, I think everybody will agree with this, we're materialistic and consumeristic societies. And I believe that we've lost any sense of the sacred, which we used to have in the past. And I floated a concept a while ago in a book, one of those books that's on that blue sheet called The Ethical Canary, which I developed in the next book, which is The Ethical Imagination, that I called the secular sacred. And I had everybody absolutely furious with me. The religious people were furious because they said I was denigrating the sacred. And the secular people were furious because I said I was trying to impose religion on them. So one of my students said to me, he said, you know, Professor Somerville, when you've got everybody mad at you, you might really be onto something. So I believe, and there's a really interesting new book by Jonathan Haidt called The Righteous Mind, in which one of the concepts he looks at is this need for a sense of the sacred. And I think that's also playing heavily in the euthanasia debate. Again, I was debating this in Australia, which is facing pushes for euthanasia all over the country. And I was arguing with this Mr. Jeff Kennett, who was the Premier of the state of Victoria. And, you know, Australians, particularly Australian men, are pretty cut and dried. You know, they don't believe in messing around with being polite or anything. So he shouted at me, he said, look, when you pass your use by or best before date, you should be checked out as quickly, cheaply, and efficiently as possible. So my reply to him was that I hadn't realized that we were products to be checked out of the supermarket. But that is, I think, as well, one of the things that's happening, that worn out people are being equated with worn out products, and they're being characterized as disposal problems. And we have to get over that. And when you think about what's involved in euthanasia, I think we've got to use straight out language. It's doctors killing their patients. And everybody has a freak out when I say that. These are the pro-euthanasia people. I was lecturing in Australia to about 600 doctors at the Australian Medical Association, and I said straight up, we can't have doctors killing their patients. And with that, one of the doctors in the audience, who's a palliative care specialist, an unusual one because he supports euthanasia, he jumped to his feet and he said, Margot, would you stop using that word killing? He said, we're not killing. I said, well, what are you doing? He said, we're doing VAE. And I said, well, what's VAE? And he said, oh, it's voluntary act of euthanasia. So you even use an acronym, so you don't use the word euthanasia. Anyway, later in the speech, I said, well, if we're going to have it, it must not be doctors. We've got to have somebody else. And this is not my original idea. And in this article that suggested this, it said, well, who are the people who can understand law and apply it very strictly? And the answer is lawyers. So what we should have is a specially trained group of lawyers who carry out euthanasia. Anyway, with that, this same guy jumped to his feet and screamed out across the audience, "Margot, are you crazy? You'd have lawyers killing people?" There you are. But you know what? This is a feature of this Quebec legislation that we had introduced last Thursday. The bill has been tabled in the legislature, and now it's open for debate. But they intend to allow doctors to give lethal injections to patients in Quebec. And that bill, it never mentions the word euthanasia, it never mentions physician-assisted suicide, it doesn't even mention the word death. What it calls it is medical aid in dying. And so that's what's happening. Now, I think another thing that we've got is we've got a fear of mysteries. And I think that's because mysteries can't be controlled and we get extremely nervous about mysteries. And so what we do is we convert the mystery of death into the problem of death, and then our usual response to problems these days is to seek a technological solution. And that is a technological solution to the problem of death, is a lethal injection. And that approach too favors euthanasia, this taking control, fear, making it a problem, seeking a technological solution. And the sort of thing that we lose is this idea, well, for example, we know that humans have got a deep moral intuition against killing other humans. In fact, when your country was sending its soldiers to fight in Vietnam, and they knew that they'd be in close hand-to-hand contact and needing to save their own lives to kill the other people, they were psychologically deprogrammed to enable them to kill. And it's very difficult for humans to kill other humans. In the American Civil War, researchers did a study of the muskets that were used, and they found that they'd been loaded multiple times with shot without ever being fired. And so the soldiers had to pretend they were doing this, they were loading it, but they were not firing at the other humans. And I think, again, we've got to take those intuitions into account. We also have the impact of scientific advances. It's got to do with our loss of the sense of the sacred. There's a couple of mistaken views here that, for example, Richard Dawkins is an example in the God delusion, the idea that we can know everything through science. I think that is wrong. I think that there are multiple ways of human knowing, and I believe that religion and faith is one of those ways. And the mistaken belief that religion and science are antithetical, they are not. And I think the new genetic discoveries have given us a sense that we can control the beginning of life. So if you put that same control at the other end of life, you would then come up with, well, we can control the end of life, namely through euthanasia. So you can contrast that scientific-based approach with a spiritual approach, which may or may not be based on religion. I believe that people are spiritual, can be spiritual whether or not they're religious. And that would tell you that there are some things that we cannot or we ought not try to control, at least through certain means. Another factor that's coming up in this debate is what it means to be human. And the big debate, and this is one that I have with my compatriot with whom I worked for 12 months, who's now here in the United States at Princeton, Professor Peter Singer. He and I totally disagree on everything, but we're friends. Peter doesn't believe that there's anything special about being human. He thinks we're just another animal in the forest. So the whole idea that, you know, that humans deserve special respect because there is something different about humans, that is denied. In fact, the arguments now are that some animals deserve more respect than humans. And there's also a discussion going on whether some robots deserve more respect than some humans. If you base whether you get respect or not on intelligence, then the argument goes that some robots are a lot more intelligent, certainly than some mentally disabled humans. Therefore, they deserve more respect. And that's where this argument comes from, that you euthanize your dog, so why wouldn't you do the same for a person that you love? Well, the answer to that is that we're not dogs, if that's what you believe, that we're different. And that the special respect that's owed to human life doesn't allow you to euthanize people. There's also this challenging of established societal values, so that all of these debates are linked and they're all part of opening up these new discussions, whether it's same-sex marriage, whether it's abortion, whether it's euthanasia that we're discussing tonight. And all of the values that have underlay those situations traditionally are now being challenged. And so it's a very difficult situation. But I think C.S. Lewis has got a worthwhile quote here that he says, we all want progress, but if you're on the wrong road, progress means doing an about turn and walking back to the right road. In that case, the man who turns back soonest is the most progressive. And there are also, and I'm not going to go into this, but within that challenging of values, you can do a coalescence of certain groups of values, and you can come up with three, what I would describe as three competing worldviews. The pure science one, Richard Dawkins. The pure mystery one, the fundamentalists who deny science, who think the world's 4,000 years old, etc. And what I've called the science human spirit view, that science is wonderful, that our human spirit is wonderful, that there's a mystery involved in this, and that if we're going to respect the mystery of life, we have to respect the mystery of death. So that's the end of that first part. Now what I think if I'm allowed to, I'll just show you the slides of this second part and I won't go into it in detail. These are the differences between the pro-euthanasia and the anti-euthanasia arguments. First of all, if you're anti-euthanasia, as I am, you believe it's inherently wrong to intentionally kill another person. If you are a moral relativist and a utilitarian, you simply ask, do the benefits of giving euthanasia outweigh its harms? And they would argue, yes, they do, because you're relieving suffering, and that's acceptable. I've already mentioned this, that the pro-euthanasia people sanitize the language. They don't speak of killing or euthanasia or suicide. They talk about things that sound like we would all want, medically assisted death, medical aid in dying. And what they do is that they create confusion between situations that are ethically acceptable, for example, rights to refuse treatment, and then say, well, all these things are the same, so if you agree with one, if you're going to be consistent, you've got to agree with the other. Okay, we won't do that one. We've got a values conflict in the euthanasia debate. We've got two values, respect for human life and respect for individual choice. And when those values compete, for pro-euthanasia people, and this is very strong in Canada, both the legislatures and the courts are absolutely adamant that autonomy is the priority value. And they argue that there is a societal consensus in Canada that autonomy always takes priority, and therefore the courts are just applying the, and the parliament are just applying the societal consensus. People who are anti-euthanasia believe that respect for life takes priority over autonomy in that situation. And the sorts of things that we have to ask is autonomy possible? And particularly with vulnerable dying people, can you really say that they are autonomous? And what is also happening, we've got a report in Quebec from the Quebec part of the Quebec legislature that looks at religion, and it expressly says that we used to be religious, but we're not anymore, and religion is passé. That's not something that would guide Quebec society now. In fact, what they're about to do, as well as introducing euthanasia legislation, is they're going to introduce legislation that they've called a Charter of Quebec's Secular Values. So we're switching right over. We've talked about this, that it's not just an argument that should be held at the individual level. It's a valid focus to look at the individual person, but it's not sufficient. It's not just a matter of personal decision making. And partly the reason for that is that law and medicine carry the value of respect for life, particularly in a secular society where you haven't got religion to do that. And you, to have euthanasia, you have to change the law, and you have to have the society approve that changing of the law, and you have to authorize physicians to carry out that killing. Pro-euthanasia people deny that there's any slippery slope. There are two kinds of slippery slope. The logical one says, the logical slippery slope is when you introduce, say, euthanasia for a very narrow group of people, but then you expand it. What we've seen is dramatic expansion in both the Netherlands and Belgium. Despite that, the Quebec government, when it looked into this, said there was no expansion of this in those countries and that there was no abuse. Abuse is the practical slippery slope, that once you introduce this, it will be used other than is allowed. And there's a lot of evidence of that. In one study, they did a survey of Belgian doctors and asked them, in the one region of Belgium, Flanders, and they asked them if they carried out euthanasia. Then the doctors who had, they resurveyed them and said, had you ever done it without the consent of the patient? 32% of the doctors had euthanized people without their consent, which is absolutely extraordinary. So, in conclusion, the euthanasia debate is momentous. I think it's the single most important debate of the beginning of the 21st century, and I think it will determine where our Western societies go. It involves our individual and collective past, as you can see there, the ethical, legal, and cultural norms handed down to us as members of families, groups, and societies, the present, whether we will change those norms, and the future, the impact that that would have on those that come after us. In debating euthanasia, we need to ask many questions, but three of the most important are, would legalization be most likely to help us or hinder us in our search for meaning in our individual and collective lives? And I've asked you this question, how do we want future generations to die? And I think we need to argue that we need to hold on trust for them, what I would call our metaphysical ecosystem, that is our values, principles, attitudes, beliefs, and not just our physical ecosystem. And we've realized that we can do damage to the physical one, we can likewise do damage to the metaphysical one. And we have to decide what sort of culture and values we want to pass on. And I finish with this slide. This is Roger Scruton, and he's referring here to marital love. He says, the world of the consenting adult, the world remade in accordance with the social contract of the enlightened liberal conscience, is, in the last analysis, a world too timid for love. And so what we can ask is, euthanasia the outcome of our failure to be able to love those who are dying, or even to love those who are just disabled, old, or frail? And in this regard, we should keep in mind that two of the main reasons people give for wanting euthanasia, pain is about number 14 on the list of a reason for wanting euthanasia. The reasons that are given are dying alone and unloved, and being a burden on others. And feeling loved, I suggest, could address and negate both of those reasons. Thank you.
Professor Somerville's slides before the talk, because otherwise I probably would have prepared a set and said, I'll just agree with everything she said and then sit down. But I was asked to talk more specifically about suffering and particularly about depression in the care of persons who are dying, and particularly in relation to the questions of assisted suicide and euthanasia, and that's what I'll concentrate on. Before I begin, though, I just want to note for all of you who do not know it, that a very good friend of mine, my mentor, a very good friend of Crossroads, a man who was also a good friend of CL, who I had the privilege of accompanying to Rimini a few years back, where he spoke, Dr. Edmund Pellegrino, passed away last week on the feast of St. Anthony. I was talking to Dr. Somerville beforehand and suggesting that I'm not sure that I can imagine what bioethics is like for the future without Edmund Pellegrino in it. So I hope you all join me in praying for him and for his family, maybe praying to him for intercession on behalf of those of us who are concerned about bioethical issues, that he might intercede before the throne of heaven on our behalf. I spent last summer for 2 weeks at Oxford at the Anscombe Center for Bioethics, and I found an interesting street sign there called Logic Lane. I'd love to live in a city that had a Logic Lane in it. But I'm going to perhaps take you down one through some of my talk before we get to the conclusions. I'm going to talk first about suffering and try to get us a little clearer about what that actually might be, and begin by distinguishing pain and suffering. First of all, to say that pain is not always a bad thing. We just have to simply recognize that. It can be a very good protective device if you touch a hot stove and run away. That's part of what pain does for us. It's a signal. There can certainly be pain without suffering. I'm the ultimate non-runner, but any of you who are marathon runners seem to enjoy inflicting this kind of pain on your on yourselves. I don't quite understand that, but if you do, you understand there can be pain without suffering. There can also be suffering without pain, and in particular, I'm going to concentrate on some of that in terms of the affective state of a person who's dying. So something like depression, and if you've known anybody who's clinically depressed, it's a deep source of suffering without any physical pain whatsoever. I think I get a clue about suffering from Hans Jonas, who says that the suffering intrinsic in animal existence, any animal, us included, is not primarily that of pain, which is occasional and a concomitant, but of want and fear. That is an aspect of appetitive nature as such. Suffering is a frustration of our appetites, according to Jonas. And human suffering is a frustration of human appetites. And it probably is easy to convince people in this room, at least many of you, that the human appetite is infinite. Right? We want to be living forever. We want to be loved totally and unconditionally. We want to enjoy all that's beautiful. But we know that that sort of infinity that's part of our built-in desire is not always our lot. Second, I want to talk about dignity, in particular in relationship to suffering, and distinguish for you between two uses of the word dignity. One I'll call attributed and the other intrinsic. Attributed dignity is the value that we attribute to ourselves or that others attribute to us. So when we use a word like a visiting dignitary, we're thinking about the value or the worth or the stature of that person in relationship to other persons and in relationship to the conditions of that person. We think about this in relation to healthcare when somebody says it's undignified for me to be wearing diapers as an adult. It's it's a sense that, that this is not something valuable. It's not how I see myself. It's not how I want others to see me. It's by attribution, what we attribute to others or to ourselves. This I will contrast with intrinsic dignity, the value that we have by virtue of being the kinds of things that we are, our intrinsic value, the value we have by being the kinds of things that we are. That's what intrinsic means. And I think that we have both an intrinsic value and an attributed value, an intrinsic dignity and an attributed dignity at one and the same time. So the intrinsic dignity is the value that we have by virtue of being the kinds of things that we are. And for human beings, at least, I think that the name we give to this value is dignity. Intrinsic dignity, then, is not the value that we have by being in control, or how we appear, or how productive we are. Rather, it's simply the value we have by virtue of being the kinds of things that we are. Martin Luther King says he learned this from his grandmother, who told him, "Martin, don't let anybody ever tell you you're not a somebody." It's the view that every one of us is a somebody, that every one of us has meaning and value even before that person has said what it means, the word means for him or for her, that is the intrinsic sense of it. It is an interest-independent value. It's the value of the person whose interests we want to respect. There's no more fundamental value than this sort of sense of dignity. It's the basis for interpersonal ethics. And I want to suggest that this portrait of Martin Luther King in the Alabama prison in Birmingham is a portrait of intrinsic dignity shining through the prison bars. People didn't attribute much dignity to him on the basis of his color. They stripped his freedom and his control. But I want to suggest to you that in this portrait, you see what it means to have intrinsic value, to have what it is, the basis of our civil rights movement, the sense of intrinsic dignity that doesn't depend on what other people think about you, how you appear to others, how much freedom or control you have. It's the value you have virtually, by virtue of nothing else but being human. Now the tension is because this dignity that we have as human beings, this value is pretty high. We also recognize that it's the value we have by virtue of being the kinds of things that we are, and we are also at one and the same time finite. And the tension between this exalted value of dignity and the fact that we are also finite, that's the nexus out of which suffering arises. We are, in a finite sense, primate mammals. We are rational, affective, mutually interdependent and social, aesthetic, free-willing, capable of grasping the finite and the infinite, capable of humor, and practically moral. We're independent in our deliberation, but we coordinate our action and we can mutually bind our wills through things like promise-making, right? If you find any other creature out there that can do all these things, a porpoise can do this, a porpoise has intrinsic dignity too, okay? If E.T. has this, E.T. has intrinsic dignity as well. But these are the kinds of things that we are, but we are also finite. So here's my refined definition of suffering. Right? To suffer is to undergo an experience that makes explicit the essential tension between the intrinsic dignity we have as human beings and the finitude that characterizes us as members of a dignified yet finite natural kind. It's a lot to say, but to put it simply, the pain of arthritis hurts, right? But it doesn't become suffering until you recognize it is limiting you and you can't open a jar, right? That's the moment it becomes suffering, okay? It makes explicit not only your value, but the fact that that value is finite. And there are two types of occasions of human suffering, broadly speaking, particularly in the medical context. One I'll call neurocognitive and the other agent narrative. What I mean by neurocognitive suffering is that that's occasioned by physiological disturbances or disruptions in our physical integrity. So pain is that. Diagnosable depression, where I believe there are biochemical disruptions in someone's brain, is neurocognitive. Delirium, nausea, seizures, all these sorts of things are occasions of human suffering, particularly at the end of life, and medicine addresses these. But there is also, particularly at the end of life, agent narrative suffering. What I mean by this is the suffering that's occasioned by disturbances in our sense of agency, our narrative histories, our relationships with other persons, etc. These are the kinds of things that we characterize as sadness, loneliness, alienation, rejection, guilt, despair, doubt, self-hatred. These kinds of things plague the sick, they plague the dying, and they are part and parcel of the suffering of dying persons. Next bit of the logic journey is a little philosophy of medicine, with respect and homage to my mentor, Edmund Pellegrino, who says you can't do ethics without the philosophy of medicine. I think we ought to think a little bit about the philosophy of therapy, what it means for a physician to be therapeutically responsive to an individual who is sick. Medicine is a kind of response to certain kinds of human suffering. It is always and primarily a response to neurocognitive suffering, but it must always be cognizant of and responsive to the agent narrative suffering that always that often accompanies neurocognitive suffering. So we respond to someone's pain, primarily, but we should also, as good doctors, be cognizant of the agent narrative suffering of that person. The person whose life it is, who is suffering from that pain, may also be lonely, may be depressed, may be alienated, etc. Now, how does medicine respond to the suffering of others? I want to give you some rules for that I call the canons of therapeutic responsiveness. This is how we act in the world as doctors. When we do things for patients, we ought to be governed by these rules that I call proportionality, parsimony, restoration, and discretion. What do I mean by proportionality? That means that our therapeutic response must fit the condition of the individual that we're trying to treat. There's both a means and proportionality and a burden-benefit proportionality. So the means and proportionality means that the means we use to treat a person who's sick must fit the end that we have in mind. So you wouldn't need and use a butter knife to do surgery. You've got to use the right tools, right? Got to be proportionate to the problem. There's also a proportionality in terms of the burdens and the benefits of the treatment. You don't want to use interferon for a cold. It can cure it, but you know, I can tell you that the suffering of interferon would be worse than the cold you're suffering from, right? So we want to make sure we're balanced in anything we're doing for the patient. The canon of parsimony says that we should not use more therapy than is necessary. Paracelsus once said famously, all medicines are poisons, therapy is a matter of dose, right? You only use, if you're really good as a doctor, you only use the right amount to treat a person, and not more or not less. This is a long quote, but I have to quote it for you just because it's so beautiful, from the German philosopher Hans-Georg Gadamer, that when therapy goes awry, most often it would not be because physical force or power was lacking or too little was exerted, but rather because there was actually too much force in play. And any of you who's a doctor should really appreciate the beauty of this. But when the act works, suddenly everything seems to happen spontaneously, lightly, and effortlessly. Particularly a surgeon, I think, appreciates this. Genuine success is accomplished in medical practice at just that point where the intervention is rendered superfluous and dispensable. All medical efforts at healing are already conceived from the outset in light of the fact that the doctor's contribution consummates itself by disappearing as soon as the equilibrium of health is restored. Right? That's parsimony. Just enough, and then I get out of the way. The patient is restored. The canon of restoration. When I'm treating somebody who's got pneumonia, right, I want to restore them back to their state of health. And that characterizes everything we want to do. We want to restore the right relationships inside the body and cure the patient if we can, or we may restore them incompletely if we can't cure the disease. We at least relieve the symptoms or mitigate the disease somehow. So in breast cancer, for instance, we might be able to cure the disease with surgery and radiation. We might be able to mitigate it by giving chemotherapy. Later on, then, if the disease can't be mitigated itself, it may be able to mitigate the symptoms, like treating pain. And even if we're doing research, we're trying to restore others in the future through the interventions for that patient. So we're always trying to restore the patient when we're doing something. We want to take a sick person and make them more of who they are. Restore them to who they are. And then lastly, the canon of discretion. That good therapy is also respectful of the limits of medicine. And we're guilty of so many violations of the canon of discretion in the 21st century. Indiscretions of degree, where we overestimate the power of medical therapy, where you may know some chemotherapy doctors who will say that the patient is better dead than leukemic, right? It's almost like blasting them with, you know, industrial strength chemotherapy, right? We think this way, that's wrong. We overstep our boundaries, don't recognize the limits of medicine. There are indiscretions of scope in which we expand the idea of medicine's discretionary space, and there are zip codes in Manhattan in which it's said that children are either gifted or on Ritalin, and there's nothing in between, right? Right, close by. And then there are indiscretions of expertise, right? Expansionist views of our own expertise as practitioners, where we go beyond what we can do. I can handle this without a referral. Bad thing for a doctor to do, right? When it's beyond what they can do. So these canons govern everything about what we ought to be doing in medicine. Now, there's no question that illness and injury attack the attributed dignity of patients. Right? Patients are robbed of their station in life. They can become disfigured. They will lose control. People can tell them when they can go to the bathroom. They lack social contribution. They become unproductive sometimes. And they can even begin in this setting to question their own worth and value. The central question behind all of medicine is whether illness and injury ultimately rob a person of their total value. My view is that illness and injury never rob a person of their intrinsic value. Illness and injury never make somebody into a nobody. The most fundamental values at stake in medicine are our duty to respond to those whose attributed dignity has been diminished by illness and injury because, and solely because, we recognize and respect their intrinsic dignity. If they've lost control, they don't lose their value. We recognize that they've lost their lost control due to illness and injury, but we recognize their value, and that's why we try to restore to them the autonomy that they have lost through illness or injury. Now let's bring it close to this question that I was asked to address about mood. Sadness and depression are common at the end of life. It is very common to be sad if one is dying. Going to be separated from loved ones, one may be unable to do things one wanted to accomplish in life. These are occasions, certainly, of agent narrative suffering for persons who are seriously ill or dying. It is also actually common to have major depression, that people's brains can actually be distorted at the end of life and they can become depressed. But I want you all to understand that depression is not natural in the face of death. And if it's diagnosable, it is treatable as a biomedical condition. And we have an obligation to do that for people and not sort of dismiss it as saying it's natural. In fact, there are good data about this. My friend and colleague Harvey Chachinoff, a Canadian, has studied this. 45% of patients who are terminally ill will endorse at some level some desire to die. But a persistent desire for death is only present in about 9%. And these 9% of people who keep saying, I want to die, have a 17-fold higher prevalence of major depression, DSM diagnosable depression, which is, again, treatable. And this desire for death is statistically associated with depression, pain, and lack of social support. The good news for the dying is that we can address all of these questions. If it's pain that's the source of their desire for death, then we can treat this with analgesic medicines and other techniques. If they're depressed, We can treat them with antidepressants and not just dismiss it as saying it's natural. We can treat that. And if it's lack of support, we can show them our care and attention and build for them a community of support through pastoral care services, through gathering friends or others or social workers, and attending to them ourselves as the healthcare professionals who are treating them. But in light of this, it should be clear that euthanasia and assisted suicide really don't have a place in care at the end of life. They undermine essentially the fundamental values of medicine, and they violate the canons of therapy. If the patient's depressed or sad, you might say, the line is blurry. Well, yes, I'll grant you that, but the fact of dust doesn't mean there's no difference between night and day, right? I can tell if somebody's sad, and I can tell if they meet the DSM manual's criteria for depression, and I will make that distinction. The key symptom that these things have in common, perhaps sadness and depression, is this feeling of worthlessness that a person might have as they're dying. Well, if the reason that they are feeling worthless is that they are clinically depressed, then we can treat the depression and restore the pathologically distorted sense of worthlessness that person has. And if they're sad, then I believe, and I hope all of you join me in believing, that we ought never ratify as rational the view that that person then has no worth. This violates the intrinsic dignity of that person, which is the fundamental reason that medicine exists in the first place, is our response to the person whose value and whose interests we are called to address. And euthanasia and assisted suicide then violate the canons of therapy. There's nothing else in medicine that makes any sense. There's no way that this makes sense in relation to anything else we do in medicine. There's no restorative aim in euthanasia, but we ought to be, as clinicians, always aiming to restore the patient and mitigate the loss. And we ought never, I think, as physicians, aim to turn a somebody into a nobody. We always want to turn a person in pain into a pain-free somebody. That's what we want to do, not into a pain-free nobody. Euthanasia and assisted suicide also violate the canon of proportionality, particularly the means-end proportionality. If the person says that they're sad, then the treatment is antidepressants. It's not 2 grams of secobarbital washed down with a fine Bordeaux. Right? This is not the way we treat somebody who's depressed. If it's not the way we treat them when they're depressed, when they are not dying, why should it become the way we treat them when they are dying? There's no sense to this. The proper interventions for sadness, if that's the cause of their sense of worthlessness, are interpersonal. They're accompaniment and upbuilding of that person. And canon of discretion is violated by this as well. The cartoon says, if you can't see it in the back of the room, before we try assisted suicide, Mrs. Rose, let's give the aspirin a chance. There are lots of things that we can do for dying patients if they are feeling a sense of worthlessness, sadness, whether it's due to sadness or depression. Suicide is also never a private act. Professor Somerville alluded to this. One way of thinking about this comes from the Jesuit psychiatrist Ned Kasem, who used to be the chief of psychiatry at Massachusetts General Hospital. He says he used to ask patients who were contemplating suicide, in whose closet do you intend to leave your skeleton? Right. It may sound a little humorous, but it's really true that suicide is in fact an act of interpersonal communication. It is not a totally self-regarding act. It has profound impact on others, and the intention of the person who's committing suicide is to communicate with others through that act. And often, the person who is contemplating suicide just wants to see, does anybody care enough to try to stop me? Right? That's what the water they're testing by even mentioning the possibility there. And if our answer is sure, here's a prescription, then they know that their worst fears have been fulfilled, that we agree that they are worthless. We should also be wary, I think, of flipping the default switch. Most of us presume that we continue to live and that others have an interest in us continuing to live. And that doctors and nurses have an interest in us continuing to live, and we generally have a presumption that we want to continue to live. But once assisted suicide and euthanasia are on the table, the default switch gets flipped. Then the person who is sick and dying and is feeling like a burden to others and is taking the time and attention of clinicians, the question for them becomes, even if we don't say it explicitly, why haven't you committed suicide yet? Why haven't you asked for euthanasia yet? Once that option is on the table, that's the default switch. Why haven't you availed yourself of this possibility? And just a little bit on filling in on some of what Professor Somerville said about the slippery slope. It is real. Depression is an indication for euthanasia in non-terminally ill patients now in Netherlands, in the Netherlands and Belgium, despite the fact that when the laws were passed, this was not supposed to be, it was only supposed to be for people who were terminally ill. But now people will say, well, I'll kill myself if you don't kill me, therefore my condition of depression is terminal, then it's morally permissible to actually euthanize legally. To legally euthanize a person who is depressed, even if they're not dying. The experience in Oregon, these are the data, they're interpreted as saying, see, there's no slippery slope, but that looks like a slope to me. it looks to be increasing every single year. The numbers are small, but in the Netherlands, it's become much greater than that. 2 to 3% of all deaths and about 20% of cancer deaths are due to euthanasia now in the Netherlands, where there's been much wider and longer experience. I'll also show you some of my own data, a study I did in the late 90s, in which if a physician, we measured a physician's sort of sense of cost control, the more frugal their attitudes about practice and about resource control, the greater was their enthusiasm for euthanasia and assisted suicide. There seems to be a strange link between those two. I guess it's about just being rational in some way. But I think, like alcohol and gasoline, cost containment and assisted suicide don't mix very well. So for the clinicians among you, or for any of you who are dealing with loved ones who might be dying and are facing the question of euthanasia or assisted suicide, my first piece of advice is not to take requests like this at face value. Think about symptom control for that person. If that's what the problem is, if it's pain, if it's nausea, try to treat that. If they're depressed, don't accept it as natural, try to treat that. But the top reasons in Oregon and Washington State for euthanasia and assisted suicide, again, as Professor Somerville suggested, are what I call agent narrative occasions of suffering. They have nothing to do with the neurocognitive occasions that are the typical things that physicians deal with. They're questions of being a burden on others, of loss of control, of loss of independence. And my view is that the proper response to those things, if we obey the canons of therapeutic responsiveness, is not to write a prescription for 2 grams of secobarbital, but to respond interpersonally with the proper treatment for agent narrative suffering. The alternatives that are available to persons who are suffering when they're dying are enormous and great. Hospice and palliative care need to be offered to such persons. We can forego life-sustaining treatments. We should do adequate pain control. Again, as Professor Somerville said, we can do more than we ever could in the first 2,500 years of Western medicine to treat patients pain, nausea, shortness of breath, etc. Even to the point, if we need to, of giving them pain medicine to the point that they become unconscious, if that's what it takes to control their pain without killing them. But above all, we have to accompany persons who are dying and never ratify the idea that a somebody has become a nobody, even or especially when that person declares himself or herself to be a nobody. So that's the end of my prepared comments, and I think we've got some time for questions, although we started late, and I think both of us went a few minutes over, but I think we've got enough time. So thank you.
happen to be a physician, but also happen to be a member of the advisory board of the Crossroads Cultural Center. And I wanted to thank our speakers, and I would start the discussion with a couple of questions that are on the theme of today. And the first question concerns the motivation that bring it to today's approach to end-of-life issues. That's the theme that Dr. Somerville covered. I happen to be professionally involved with cancer patients, and Dr. Sulmasy pointed out to the Oregon and Washington experience. And what I found extremely interesting is that in that Washington and Oregon experience, a prospective poll was done of patients who requested information about assisted suicide or termination of life. And I'm sorry, I have number-oriented professionally, so I think it was 144 patients. And patients were given the opportunity to quote multiple reasons. But what was extremely striking is the fact that the most common reason was loss of control, but that had nothing to do with a physiological condition. Only a minority of patients quoted the loss of bodily function, loss of independence in moving around as the main reason for asking that. And it seems to me that if you think of the situation as seen from the patient point of view, that points to the fact that the patient recognizes a value in their humanity, which is not necessarily related to a medical intervention or to a medical answer to their need. So I would be interested in your comments because you addressed the motivations for that.
First,
go
first.
I don't know where to start. Following up on something Dr. Sulmasy said about when you're referring to Dr. Chochinov's work, they also have a couple of other studies that I think are very important in this context and relating to motivation. With a group of advanced patients with ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, they were able to distinguish depression from another clinical syndrome that they called hopelessness. And the characteristic of hopelessness was that you had absolutely nothing to look forward to. And I think that I think that is fundamental to wanting to live, to sort of the will for life in humans. I'm extremely interested in hope. A reporter once asked me what was the favorite line I'd ever written, you know? And it's sort of egocentric, I know, but I knew immediately what it was. It is that hope is the oxygen of the human spirit. Without hope, our spirits die. And so what we've been talking about quite a bit, and I know Dr. Chochinov personally, and I occasionally chat to him, is about giving dying patients what could be called mini hopes. You can't tell them you're going to be alive, you know, for another 10 years because you know that's not true. But that doesn't mean that there's nothing you can't have something to look forward to, whether it's to get up before the sun in the morning and see the sun come up, or a visit from your granddaughter that you could organize for the person. And I think we've been very remiss in doing that. And the other thing, just in terms of your question, is they also in another study found that on average people asking for euthanasia change their minds about wanting it every 12 hours. So if you happen to get them at the time that they wanted it, and you did it, they didn't have a chance after that to change their minds. But I'm not sure how we're going to handle this. Because once you, when you look at the pro-euthanasia argument and that it's autonomy, it's a right to control, it's choice, and it's my life anyway. You know, that's what they say, whose life is it anyway? And recently, Dr. Marcia Angel, who was the editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, she's just published an article and she's very pro-euthanasia. And in it she said, well, they're going to die anyway. And she, well, that's true of all of us. We're all going to die anyway. And so the question in euthanasia is not if we die, it's how we die, and whether some means of dying are not ethically acceptable. But it's a very hard argument to get across.
Yeah, I agree that the control theme is a very big one. But I also think it's important for society to recognize, and again, it may be hard to sort of convince everyone of this, but if we were to try to be reflective about it, you know, being in control, while it might be a value that people are looking for, is ultimately an illusion. The most important things about us are totally outside of our control. The fact that any of us is born is not something we controlled. You had no choice in your being born, right? No matter how good genetic engineering becomes, you will never choose your biological parents, right? This is a metaphysical impossibility. You cannot choose not to die, right? All people are mortal. This is philosophy 101. And you can't make somebody love you, right? Because the moment that you're in control and it's not a free choice on their part, it's no longer love. So if the most important thing about a human being is being in control, and that's your philosophy, you have a philosophy that can't account for birth, death, or love, and I suspect that's not a very good philosophy. You know, with respect to the question of hopelessness, let me take a slightly different stand. I agree that that's a very serious issue, David Kissane has also written on the demoralization syndrome as well, that can affect people who are at the end of life, I think is akin to this. I'm not sure, however, that the mini hopes theory is very helpful, because being terminally ill doesn't make one unable to understand what's going on. And if every hope we give them is progressively shorter than the one before, they're going to get the picture, right? So my view is that the hopelessness that occurs is one in which people have not looked to what is the desire, right? Hope in the end is a kind of desire. At least that's what Aquinas said. It's a desire with a special kind of an object. And if you're dying, right, the object has to be something that is attainable, possible to attain, yet difficult to attain, right? And if you're dying, you've then got to have an object for your hope that goes beyond death. And that, the only thing that meets that kind of a criterion is meaning, right? And what real hopelessness means is meaninglessness. And so what we have to do, I think, for helping dying patients is to grapple to help them to recover or to discover or to hold on to whatever they hold, whatever for them is a source of meaning, which certainly for Christians is the triune God and the gospel made manifest in Jesus Christ, but it is for any other person, whatever can for them be an object that can transcend even their own death. And that, again, in a secular society is a difficult sell, but I think that that's the only kind of true hope that a person can have when they're dying, if we really want to have something that transcends, you know, those little, you know, mini hopes.
Yeah, I agree with you, Dan. And actually, Dr. Chochinov has another article that's called Dignity Therapy. Yeah. And so he talks in that about how you can get the person to write their life narrative and feel that their life had meaning and that that's what they're leaving to other people. Yeah.
So let's open the forum to the audience if there are questions. Please.
Dr. Somerville, in Canada, you're bucking such a terrible tide. How do you get yourself up on your horse and put your shield up and sally forth to do battle? When, what hope is there that you will ever change the climate there? I mean,
Well, I come from the outback of Australia. And so, you know, I've had a lot of experience with facing people that disagree with me. I mean, I was at a conference once, and this eminent man from Texas, a big tall man, really very handsome and that, and I was sitting at dinner table, and he walked up behind me and he started patting me on the head like this. He said, "I just can't believe it. A little girl like you telling all these grown men what to do." So I've had a lot of practice, but I'll tell you what I believe. I hope that we could prevail, because I believe that's the best thing for future societies. But I don't become depressed if I don't think we are at the moment. And what I believe is that it's extraordinarily important that we try to do what we think is the right thing, whether or not we succeed. That's where we fail if we don't try. And so I'm a bit of an incurable optimist, but you're right, I get a huge amount of flack. I mean, unbelievable. You just need to look at yesterday's Globe and Mail, and there's 120 comments about an article I wrote, and 120 of them are attacking me personally. But I actually take that as a good sign, because if there was something in the article that they could attack, they would attack that. But they haven't attacked any of the arguments that I put out. They've just attacked me. In fact, one of them wrote that they wish that, because Globe and Mail is like our New York Times in Canada, it's our national newspaper. And one of them wrote, "Well, I don't know why you keep publishing that Somerville. It's really terrible. If you really want to publish the ridiculous views she has, you should just get the Catechism of the Catholic Church and put it on the Globe's website." So, you know, it,